I am really excited now to introduce her to you and to introduce her work to you. So please welcome Elika Ortega.
Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. And thank you, Aaron, so much for the invitation. I also wanted to make a mention of that time when we met at UC Boulder. Because that was pretty much the beginnings of this project that I'm going to be talking about today, which is still kind of like halfway through. So there's a lot of in-progress work, so any feedback is really, really welcome. So thank you to your, you know, to your labor that you were doing at the Media Archaeology Lab. I was able to find like a bunch of really good materials that enriched this project and made it what it's becoming at the time. And yes, the same, like, it was great to be able to work with you and just become like instant friends and think and just find such a great colleague that always thinks that what I think is cool, as we were saying before. So, okay, I'll get started. Please raise your hand if you have any questions at any moment or if something sounds like too weird. I'm happy to explain everything. Because I'm talking about works that really, really sit at the intersection of print and digital. Sometimes it gets really meta, and sometimes it gets a little confusing as to, are you talking about the print, are you talking about the digital, are you talking about what happens in the middle, or just stop me if you have questions. So what I'm going to do tonight is kind of like go through these points. They're not very long. So first I'm going to talk a little bit about the media and literary frameworks that inform the project. Then also the kind of like the theory aspects that inform the idea of reading practices, the changing of reading practices, as well as gestures. Then I'm going to stop a little bit in three examples that I really think are key to understanding this phenomenon. And I very purposefully chose one between page and screen that was published in the US, then El Libro del Fin del Mundo, the book of the end of the world, that was published in Argentina, and El Libro de Poesía del Libro that was published in Brazil. So the idea, the reason why I chose this is just to show that this is not a phenomenon that occurs in a particular region, but it's something that is happening pretty much everywhere where we look, even though I thought it was very very small. It turned out to be a big phenomenon. And I'm going to talk a little bit, after we go through the examples, what kind of reading mechanisms these works have in common and what brings them together, because they're actually very different works. So I'm looking at them from a different from a perspective of what brings them together too, since they're so different. And then a few conclusions, which I should really call preliminaries because they're not really concluding conclusions. I should say that I'm gonna read a little bit first, and then I'll just change to just talk about the words, which are the most fun part. I'll begin with that. 2007 marked the publication of Media Poetry, an international anthology edited by the Brazilian poet and artist Eduardo Cac. This anthology was a reedition as well as an expansion of a previous volume published in 1996 titled New Media Poetry. Included in the 2007 edition was an introduction to the earlier volume. Side by side with the newer introduction, Cac in 2007 reflected upon the fundamental change in our engagement with digital media during the previous decade. The shift from new media poetry, sported in the title of the earlier 1996 edition of the anthology, to media poetry, signaled a familiarization with digital and electronic technologies, both in poetry as well as in everyday life. The question Cac warns us is the implications of the expansion and acceleration of media that will impact poetic creative processes, media convergence, ubiquity, and portability. A reading of the two introductions reveals a crucial thread of unstable, temporal, and affective approaches to digital media. On the one hand, an imperative of progressive experimentation in 1996 that symptomatically for the turn of the century looks to the future, which is the one that I have here. A new poetry for the next century, says Cac, must be developed in new media, simply because the textual aspirations of the authors cannot be physically realized in print. The old storage medium created by Gutenberg must now be replaced by floppy and hard disks, CDs, CD-ROMs, DVDs and super CDs, magneto-optical disc, tape, and holographic film. This is 1996, so of course all of this was looking to the future. If we look 20 years later, it's like, oh boy, whatever happened to the floppy disks? And on the other hand, a redefinition of poetry and its media viewed not just as a storage media, but as a wide array of materials and surfaces that take shape during the that have taken shape during the 10 years separating the two editions of the anthology. With that decreased enthusiasm, but not less a visionary tone, CAC in 2007 instead talks of, I do have this, works created with, through, and for media, and environments as diverse as video, electronic displays, computers, holograms, biotechnology, early and contemporary digital networks, cellular phones, and other mobile media, skywriting, and its logical consequence, outer space. Still, there seems to be an underlying assumption in CAC's propositions that print sits outside of media, which he presented as technological systems of production, distribution, and receptions. That is, mainly as digital media. Incidentally, he did end up doing a space poem, this inner telescope that was just launched in the in the International Space Station in February, was this little thing floating that you see here. It's a poem that he designed on Earth, gave the design to Thomas Pesquet, the astronaut, who is based at the International Space Station, with the instructions on how to build it. And then he did build it, and I guess kind of like let it float around. It's designed for zero gravity, so the floating around is part of the poetics. What I find really interesting about CAC is this progression of his thinking from having a very linear, progressive, technological take as to what poetry was going to become, and then a more nuanced aspect of it that looks at what media does and how poetry can be created with that media, as it happens here, through that media, and for that media. So it's not just a storage medium, as he was thinking about at the beginning, at the end of last century, and then how that progresses, and how that actually gets to, how it actually gets made or actualized. So now I'll continue. Media, nevertheless, is a much more complex set of technocultural developments that include means of production, distribution, and reception. But also, as pointed out almost 10 years ago by Lisa Gittleman, the practices and protocols associated to them. So the media is not just the object that we can engage with, but also all of the practices that they involve, whether they're gestures as, you know, touching a touchscreen and, you know, all of the gestures that we can do on a touchscreen, or the things that we can do with a mouse. All of that is part of the media, too. At this juncture, a renewed understanding of print has emerged from theorizations of the digital. Now, we not only see print as a system of production, distribution, and reception of its own accord, but also an undeniable part of the technological, digital, and electronic realm. Despite a pervasive ideology of linear progress most evident in technological cycles of planned obsolescence, the media landscape we inhabit is multiplex and moves simultaneously in various directions. Approaches to this plurality, like the post-digital, investigates, and this is, I forget his first name, Florian Kramer. He says, the state of affairs after the initial upheaval caused by computerization and global digital networking of communication, technical infrastructures, market, and geopolitics. This state, according to Kramer, constitutes both a disenchantment with digital media and a revival of analog media. Furthermore, Kramer points out that the post-digital eradicates the distinction between old and new media, in theory as well as in practice, with the objective to move past the stock of default approaches. The last media framework I would like to mention is the work of Siegfried Zielinski, for whom the study of media variants, those objects of media that didn't amount to technological revolutions, allow for the discovery of fractures or turning points in historical master plans that provide useful ideas for navigating the labyrinth of what is currently firmly established. In the next few minutes, I'll look at Amaran Borsuk's Between Page and Screen, Belén Gatches, El Libro del Fin del Mundo, The Book of the End of the World, and Giselle Bagelman's El Libro Después del Libro, the Book After the Book, as examples of works whose poetic emerged from their hybrid print-digital composition, but also from the gestures they demand to be read. In literary circles, both creative and critical, the endurance of print can be attributed to its still undeniable, strong, and prestigious standing. Nevertheless, this should not be understood as marking a stark divide between the print and digital poetic production of the 21st century. As Luis Correa Diaz and Scott Weintraub have stated, how the present state of media does not mean the end of the previous era. On the contrary, it is about long-term coexistence, and in many cases, it implies a feedback loop that does nothing but amplify the creativity and quality of the literary objects. Giselle Bagelman, I should show you this. So she published this book that is a continuation of a digital work that is pretty much a dissertation on the changing practices of publishing. And she has very interesting theoretical as well as aesthetic proposals in it. She poses that she conceptualized a literature in or off transit, a text that can only be read in flux, transmitted between machines, turned between computers. Writers like the ones explored here, Borsuk, Bagelman, and Gatche, participate in this and have diversified their creative material apparatus by profiting from the tensions and harmonies, the rhetorics and expressiveness at the intersection of print and digital media, as well as the emerging effects brought about by the fusion of both. A couple of interesting conceptualizations too is the idea of practice before moving on to the idea of gesture. I really like the work of Johanna Drucker that she's done in what she terms to be the distributed architecture, which for her means that a book should be conceived as a distributed object, not a thing, but a set of intersecting events, material conditions, and activities. And similarly, a different conception of artifacts, books, documents, works of textual or graphic art, one in which reception is production, and therefore all materiality is subject to performative engagement with varied and specific conditions of encounter. What I really like about this idea is how she moves from the idea of the reader as the writer to the idea of reception as production. And the gestures that I'm going to be talking about with these works is really that exercise between the reception and the production that happens in a performative engagement, as performative engagement. Bagelman also has some ideas about the changing nature of practices, which doesn't necessarily map out to the changes in technology itself. For her, the long history of reading and written culture shows that revolutions in practices are much slower than the technological ones. And I guess this is something that we can sort of relate to every time we see updates to the design of, for example, social media pages and so on, and how, even though it's not that difficult to get used to them, there is always an unfamiliarity to them. So as the pace of design or of device development advances more and more, we also experience how our practices take a little bit slower to change. Similarly, for Bagelman, these practices, these kinds of revolutions, cannot happen just at the technological aspect or just at the practical individual realm, but they also modify political, semiotic, and juridical practices that surround the idea of writing and reading, as well as publishing. Here we are. And lastly, for this idea, very famously in 1982, Walter Ong published this seminal work on technologies of writing, in which he posits technologies of the world do not merely store what we know, they also style what we know. And he was talking about typography and written culture, but that is something that we can extrapolate to the digital realm as well. In terms of gestures, Maria Angel and Anna Gibbs have made interesting propositions about gestures in digital literature. For them, to grasp or to handle a concept, an object, or a text is to introduce a human dimension through the figure of the hand and its capacity for manipulation and gesture. And this idea of the hand is going to be really interesting as we're going to see how it kind of gets manifested in some of these works. Moreover, they say, the body marks the side and sign of the intimate relationship rather than the absolute divide between digital and print media. And even though some of the mechanisms that we see in these works are machinic or electronic, many of them are also human, so they require us to do some kind of action with our hands to read them. Finally, as we'll see in the examples, media mediate an outer physical activity, what we do with our bodies in acts of mediation. Each of the works that I'm going to be talking about creates specific reading conditions that take the reader from one device to another through mechanisms, technical as well as human, that can be as varied as metaphors and an individual style. They are also not different editions of the same content, but inseparable facets of a single work. At the most basic level, the four works establish a metaphorical as well as a material bridge, the mechanism, that is, between the print instantiation and the digital one. As I will explain in a second, or as we will see in a second, the enactment of the mechanism unfolds the reading of the work in a series of gestures or performative movements. Now, I believe some of you have already seen or played a little bit with between page and screen. Yeah, raise your hands, some of them, yeah. Good. So, awesome. Between Page and Screen is an augmented reality book of poems, which is a very succinct definition to suggest the complexities that happen in a work like this. Jessica Pressman has described it as a hybrid reading practice that is not just about using multiple media, but also about bridging and blending them. Between Page and Screen, I have it right here, and I can pass it around to you in a second. Between Page and Screen is made up of a print book and a website and a webcam. And the webcam, you would say, is not really part of a work, but in this case, it is really central to how it is. So we have the book that I'm holding here in my hand, and we have the website, which kind of looks like a regular, you know, book website that has different sections about the book, how to buy it, the do-it-yourself, I'll talk about it in a second, the help and the contact. But really it's the read where we should focus our attention, which again comes with a set of instructions as to what to do, and when we're ready to read it, for those of you who haven't seen it, be ready to be surprised. When we show the QR code, I should have said the print book is only made up of geometrical patterns that aren't, you know, necessarily the kind of content that we would expect in a book. And the only text that we have is the front matter, the titles, the editorial minutiae, and so on, and of course, well, the back cover, I guess. But then... when we put it together with its digital component, with the augmented reality engine that is running on the website, then we do get the poems in augmented reality. In this case, the poems have to do with the relationship between P and S, which stand for page and screen. And as you can see, reading them is actually not that easy. And some of them are animated. Some of them have, the ones that aren't the letters between P and S have to do with the etymologies of the two words or with, I guess, approaches to their relationship. What I'm hoping to be able to find just now as I'm showing to you is the weirdness of reading this. On the one hand, we have the surface and the surfaces that are involved in it. We have the surface of the book, which we can show backwards too, by the way. So that requires a certain kind of gesture that becomes essential to reading the work. If we show it just like this, as we would show the book to a person, then we end up with a backwards letter, and with the animated ones, this is not it. Yeah, they're still because they're mobile, they're still readable. But in order to read the letters, we need to do an interesting manipulation, and again, the hand becomes important as to what we're supposed to do in order to read. And I can pass it around if you have your webcam. You can maybe look at it. But as a material object, it's really interesting. It moves away a lot of these protocols and a lot of these practices as a book that we would normally have. If we are used to having a book and flipping to the pages, that is definitely a gesture. But with this one, we're not only not able to read the book, let's say, by sitting on a park bench, we really do need the connection to the internet and the website and the webcam. When we were solving the technical difficulties before and we were going to use this computer, we realized there was no webcam. So really the architecture and the media components of the works extend beyond the book and really beyond the website. It's not just the website, it's the infrastructure that we need for it as well. All right, let's go to the following one. The following one, El Libro del Fin del Mundo, the book at the end of the world, or of the end of the world, I never know how to translate it. I don't really need the slide. This was written by Belén Gache, who's an Argentinian poet who lives in Spain currently. And I guess, again, the components of the book now are made up by the book that comes with a CD-ROM that a lot of computers don't even have a slot for anymore. But it has a really interesting publication history. Some of the digital poems included in the CD-ROM were originally published online and then gathered as a collection as a whole collection. The book has a really interesting narrative too. It opens with the story of let me remember the name, Ulrico el Consecuente, who was this is all fiction. Who was a tyrant who ordered all of the books of his city to be burned, and then when he dies, his successor orders a recovery project to get as many fragments as they can. And those fragments are supposedly gathered here. So this is a gesture that is very common in many Latin American works like Borges or Cortázar, that just gathers, a bunch of stories into a larger story. And some of the things that Gache is doing here is really just really small vignettes or really small stories. And some of them live in the book, in the print book, and some of them live in the CD-ROM. Years later, after the publication of El Libro del Fin del Mundo, a lot of the works and some others were published as war toys online. And this work has been active since 2006. So this is a pretty old work as well. Between Page and Screen was 2012. This is 6 years before that. And it is interesting too the kind of work that Belén Gache does in this sense, because she's starting from a project that was a book, albeit one with a CD-ROM, and then recreates this as a book again. And it has this funny effect. I don't know if you can hear it. I think this is audio. There it is. So it has this remediation of, the turning of the pages and so on. But really, I mean, that has become kind of cliche now and is perhaps not that exciting for anybody. But one of the things that are really exciting about this project is, and this is in one of the slides. Let me just find it. is the kind of navigation that it invites. No, it didn't make it into slides, but I'll show you. So it has a bunch of, some of the pages that refer to the digital poems, to the digital works that are originally in the CD-ROM but now on the website, have this little icon that is a hand, almost a manicure, holding a CD, indicating, now take the CD, you know, put it to work and read it. And they're usually accompanied by a little bit of text, a little bit of context as to what the piece, the digital piece, is supposed to do, and then she sends you over to the digital work. So the one that I think is really worth showing, just let me find it, is this one, Mariposas Libro, which is a butterfly book, or book butterflies. And in this case, it's as a page, it's really just a placeholder. But then, both in the CD-ROM and on the website, it really comes alive. So what this piece does is, every time we click on a butterfly, we get a quotation about butterflies from some classics in literature. In this case, well, we have that one. This is from Lacan. This is from Abel Posse, from Gabriel Garcia Marquez, from Alejandra Pizarnik, from Freud, from José Lezama Lima. And some of these, also very interestingly, have been crowdsourced, which is something that Gacha would have never been able to do in print or even in the CD-ROM. It would be self-contained. But once it is sent online, then people can, you know, submit their butterfly quotations from, you know, whatever writer, even in any language that they choose to. And I'm trying to get, oh, no, it's not. This is not it. But there's a few of them in French and a few of them in English. We would just have to keep on clicking to find them. But the idea of the extension of having just a placeholder on the page that is one of these fragments found by the successors of Ulrico y Consecuente, and they become even more scattered. If before they were scattered between the pages and between the CD-ROM, then online become even more scattered and even more distributed with the crowdsourcing aspect of it. All right. And finally, the last example that I have is, I've been mentioning it already before, Jesse Begelman's The Book After the Book. This also has an interesting publication history. It was created originally as this digital work in 1999, and then a couple of years later, 3 years later, it was published as a print book. So they really weren't meant to be a single work initially, but in the print book we can see Gisè Begelman really revisiting a bunch of the ideas and the questions that she poses on the website. Also interesting too is that the digital one was published in Portuguese as well as in English, whereas this one was only published in Portuguese. So that also speaks of the different affordances and potentialities that each of the authors sees in their works. So I'll just show you a little bit of this, and then we can talk, and then we can talk about the print in a little bit. So what we see is a very common practice in electronic literature, which is trying to obscure the words with the code or the code with the words, and so on. And it really just looks like random characters. But can we maybe read something here? Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And she's playing with that. I mean, this is something that we could just, like, you know, not even notice. But she's using it there, and it becomes this really this labyrinth that is clickable anywhere. And then we end up with this index of the book after the book that looks like a, you know, just like a website directory. And it doesn't necessarily look like an index as we would imagine it in a book context. We have, you know, p.0, np.0, grammatology, scroll, bookshelves, and so on. It really, I mean, it really correlates to the aesthetics of the website, especially for the 90s, I guess. But the argument that she's making in terms of, you know, what is happening to publishing and to reading and to writing in terms of the book, when you put it like this and you name it an index as opposed to a directory, then it plays with the protocols associated to each one of them. And trigger warning, it gets a little flashy, so if somebody doesn't like flashy things, this is a good time to close your eyes. this is not that much. But she's playing with the idea of text and image. And of course, the animation reinforces that, changing from text to image, from text to image, from text to image. And then taking us with a little bit of navigation, not really an orientation. It's really just like going here or going there. Another one, this is the flashiest one. Also kind of showing the difficulty of making these arguments in the context of, you know, of an animation like this, but really making very interesting and in some cases, I guess, in 1999, sort of controversial declaration. So I guess it doesn't seem like that so much anymore. But after more than 500 years, we're facing the development of a new form of written culture, which is a hybrid of digital and printed substrata. The library idea does not organize knowledge anymore. It functions as node of a network, a set of revolving shelves, a new reading machine. And this is probably enough torture for you. But this idea of the network and the nodes really resonates with something that she ends up doing when she published the print book. If she was just sort of theorizing about what was happening to publishing in 1999, in the years that followed the publication of the digital publication of the book after the book, then they solidify in this. Another one that I want to show you is this, the grammatology, which is kind of like the rules, I guess, to read this book. Let's give it a second. So two important things is she says this website would like to be part of Jorge Luis Borges's The Book of Sand. Does anybody know The Book of Sand by Jorge Luis Borges? Yeah. So this is a really interesting short story, and, you know, it has this infinite ideas, as most of Borges' story has, where the protagonist is visited by a bookseller, and the bookseller is selling The Book of Sand, which is a book that you can never find the same page again. They're not sequential, so if you open the book to page 50, the following page would be perhaps 370, and the following one would be 10,103. And so they're non-sequential, they don't amount to a single whole. They spread and they spread. So this is one of the bigger considerations that Begelman has there. And then the directions, the instructions to read this. What we find is a page, an HTML page, but this is of course not the actual HTML page that we would need to display the HTML page. This is when it gets kind of meta, as I was saying. So, if we were to read behind this particular page, we would find that there is an actual HTML that is not showing. But that is making this to look like it's bare HTML. So again, so she's playing with the idea of image and word and what gets shown, what doesn't get shown, what gets, in this case, let's say, printed on the screen, and what is not printed behind the screen too. So the other one I wanted to show you, I believe it's in the index. It's probably... I was on this one, but this is a good one too. I think it's this one. Nope. So this is what happens with these works. They're not easy to find. It is this one. So yeah, just a rotation of some of her arguments, which then in the book become this block of text. So what she's doing in terms of animation and profiting from the affordances of what she can do with the little flash animations that she uses in the website, then in this case becomes a text, a block of text, which is also profiting from the affordances of the print book and also pushing us to read in a different way. If we're reading most of the essays, you know, left to right, top to bottom, in this case we're still reading top to bottom but vertically, so moving a little bit away the protocols of the book. I'll pass it around, but it's also interesting that just as we saw on the index that she's playing with the idea of the directory as the index, in this case her table of contents in the book become sort of the installation guidelines for a program. So we have something like minimal requirements, installation, setup, restart, exit, a README text, and the source code, and so on. So she's playing again with the protocols of what we would do between an index and a table of content. How am I doing for time? All good?
7:49.
Okay, awesome. So I may have... Yeah. Oh, here they are. So now I want to move on to some of the mechanisms that we can find in common with these works. So one of them is reading is handling, but also reading as handling, or handling as reading. We're having a couple of issues right now. Stop. There it goes. So reading is handling, or reading as handling, or handling as reading. As we see when we play with between page and screen, it's really a matter of using your hands and even tilting your head a little bit and so on. As we see in the book of the end of the world, this is the icon I was trying to show you. You probably already saw it with the book going around. It's really prompting a manual action to continue reading and to complete the reading of the work. The other mechanism that we can see in all of this work is the hybrid languages. In between page and screen, we see these non-human but machine-readable codes that will become words eventually. In the page that I was showing from the book after the book, we have this HTML that is sort of remediated HTML, but it's also highly readable, I guess, in the way that she displays it. So again, playing with what is machine readable and what is human readable, but then sort of making them both accessible. And finally, the hybrid languages on the multilingualism side. El libro del fin del mundo plays a lot with Spanglish. Even the title "Word Toys," the title of the remaking, plays a lot with Spanglish. Some of the works in there do as well. And the book after the book, of course, was published, the digital version anyway, was published in a bilingual edition. So these are some of the things that I guess these three authors have been really invested in profiting from and in proposing. On the one hand, using hybrid languages as machine, but also human, but also I guess at the end of it, also verbal language, but also body language and the kind of handling that we have to do for the reading of these works. All right, so some of the preliminary conclusions. One of the things that these works do is they reveal that they cannot exist in one medium alone and still be completely apprehended. If we happen to have only the CD-ROM for El Libro del Fin del Mundo, we end up with only a tiny collection that is only a portion of the whole work. Similarly, between page and screen can literally not be read if we don't have a webcam. In the case of Bagelman's work, perhaps it's a little less solid that complementarity that both components have. But once we see the extent of the whole project, it becomes evident that one or the other are not necessarily the whole picture of it. They also propose non-default uses of their media. Just as we saw with Between Page and Screen, this is really not a default use of a book. We had to show it to a camera, hold it in a weird way, and so on. Similarly, CD-ROMs or the kind of reading in the block of text that I show you in the book after the book, they're not necessarily what we would consider the default uses of a book or the default uses of a CD-ROM. Their poetics, they're all really great works of literature, and the poetics and the verbal poetics or the narrativity of all of them are really, really great. But a big part of their poetics emerge in part from the media configuration. So the experience of going through the manipulation of the works and the experience of going from one to the other, of realizing how they complement each other, is a big part of that poetics. And the gestures are key to create meaning and are integral to the part, to the act of reading. If we don't move from one to the other, then we're missing part of the work. However, these are not by any means stable models. We can observe a similar publishing dynamic in textbooks. And that is part of the project that I'm currently investigating. It's become actually a pretty profitable business model for textbook publishers to have a digital component, whether it's just a website. But before, it used to be CD-ROMs, and even encyclopedias that used to come in CD-ROMs as well. So that is interesting to see how even though it's not a stable model for publishing in terms of literature, because these are very experimental in many ways, it is a sort of stable publishing model for textbooks. So the question there is, does the content matter? Does the objective of the book matter for this kind of interplay in between the two media or not? And in any case, so these three works and a few others being such experimental works, they sort of become an incunabula of what we see in the first few decades of digital reading, writing, cultural changes. One of the slides that I skipped had a suite of examples from other places around the world, some from Poland, some more from the US, some more from Latin America. But interestingly, the oldest one that I've been able to trace is from 1985. So this is even before the popularization of the internet and before that tipping point of digital media becoming so ubiquitous. So what is happening is not necessarily after that, but what's happening even before that. So we see this again, this feedback loop of the interactions between the two kind of media. And that is all I have. Thank you so much. I'm happy to answer any questions. Yes.
Since this is such a new field, I'm wondering because there's obviously a lot you can do creatively, but I'm wondering if it's been criticized in any way for being, one, elitist, because you have to have the technology to understand, and so it's not accessible to everyone, even though more and more people, of course, have access to the digital world. And I'm also wondering if there are people who think that all of the interaction actually detracts from the language and the written word, if that's a criticism of the field.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there's been a lot of that, and they're both perfectly valid criticisms to it. On the accessibility part, it's on the one hand elitist, because it's necessary to have all of this technology. And that has been, I guess, an issue that has been discussed in general with all of electronic literature, as it's always been very avant-garde, and it's always been dependent on new technological developments. There's along the same lines, there's the other side of it. If you saw, you know, passing around El Libro del Fin del Mundo, we see this CD-ROM that a lot of computers cannot even read anymore. So that adds the other side, I guess, or it's the other side of the coin of accessibility. On the one hand, definitely access to the technology and access to broadband and all of these things. But now, as time goes by, it becomes also a matter of access to now all technology, as you know, as a media archaeology lab where Aaron and I met, and which is why I was doing research there too. So yeah, that's definitely part of the problem. In response to the other criticism that you mentioned, it definitely distracts from the written word. But I argue that the written word is not central anymore. So the gesture is just as central as the written word. So that distraction is a layer of meaning-making processes and meaning-making performative engagements that add to the reading. And I don't want to say that makes up for what you don't see in terms of the words, but it changes it, it modifies it, and it complements it, or puts it in tension too, which might be the case, as a more harmonic kind of fusion of the two media and the two ways of reading, but also as a tensioned one, as in, you know, what happens there, what is the struggle between that?
The analogy I think of is if you think about film and how, you know, film adds something to the writing and the text, but it also takes away from the imaginative aspect of what you envision, say, when you read the book or the play, versus what is presented to you on the screen. So I can see it going both ways.
Yeah, definitely. And I guess El Libro del Fin del Mundo makes it very evident, because the story itself is a story about fragments and gathering them. So the action of going from one to the other rehearses or enacts that idea of gathering fragments too. So in that sense, it adds a lot of meaning, while at the same time there might be some distraction from the word. Yeah. Yes?
I mean, I don't know if I agree at all. Because in film and the writing are completely from media separated. I mean, the fact that they're connected by having one borrow from the other, I mean, it's irrelevant. I mean, so is, I don't know, sculpture or, you know, whatever else, right? So, in the same way is the fact of having objectified paper or not. That's actually not really connected to the fact of presenting a multi-dimensional kind of product. For example, you can have a totally digital thing that has no paper whatsoever and be exactly like a book. Read, that's it. Yep. Which is most stuff, actually, no? And on the other hand, you can have a book that is made only of paper, you can have one of those books that pops out and has a castle on it or whatever, and you say, figure it out, you play with it. And it's a immersive, performative thing. Mm-hmm. So I don't really think that there's a dichotomy between paper and paper. Paper is just a medium in the old sense, in the Latin sense, which is a material, right? So I don't see the economy being in between those two things, but in between willing to do only that short thing, which is totally fine, or willing to do a multidimensional thing, which is totally fine too. It's just a separate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I definitely agree with you, and one of the things that draws me to these projects is precisely how they problematize this supposed dichotomy between what is print and what is not print, and how they bring it together, and it's harmonious and poetic in many ways, but it's also problematic and complicated and messy and sometimes not that pleasant even. But it's still an interesting aesthetic engagement with it. But yeah, definitely, I agree with you. Like, what each of these works do, it has to do with the media that they use, but it's not limited to the defaults. Like, that, this is how they get past those defaults that I was talking about. Yeah, definitely. Thank you. Yes.
I mean, that strikes me as really interesting, especially because you have the CD-ROM and then you have the one that's flash and the one that's webcam. It sort of reminds us that the ways we read are going to change and sort of become obsolete, right? Because, mm-hmm. you know, I know this is obvious to you because this is what you work on, but it made me think about that. Anyways, I just want to thank you for that sort of obvious intervention. We read changes and it has to change, and sometimes that means things that we read are going to have to fall by the wayside or reinvent themselves, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious if there are plans for, like, the CD-ROM book to get reinvented some way that would make it possible for, like, your MacBook Air, right? So.
Yeah, I mean, not that I know of in that kind of format. Some works have been ported into USB drives or just put online, which I guess becomes the catch-all kind of solution. And then, yes, yeah, your comment is spot on. Like, some of them, you know, have become obsolete. What I also find fascinating about these works is the how much they emphasize and underscore the stability of the book. The codex is right. and they're so experimental and they're so avant-garde in many ways, but they have this axis that runs from the 80s up until now, in which we have this print material that, you know, kind of connects them all. And I guess that is the thread that brings them together. Which is not to say, you know, forget about everything digital, let's just stick to print. But it's interesting to see all of these interactions, and this is why I think this become sort of incunabula too. Because there, I mean, I don't know if at some point that is going to stop happening or not, but it's really interesting to see how print continues to influence and to talk to all of these technologies, whether they become obsolete or not. Yeah, yeah, thank you. Any more questions? Excuse me?
It's
sorry. It was outside. I was like, who was that?
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.